Very nasty cytotoxic venom. Right, that all being said, let us go back to the page with the actual animal. And well done for those of you who guessed it. It's a tricky one. It caught me out completely. That one morning that I started when it was pouring with rain, that it was, I've got a very itchy nose. It's the damp. The one where it was pouring with rain and we skidded around the corner to try and get the car back into undercover safely. All right, let me just try and figure out how my index works. I thought I could find the page, but I can't. There we go. Oh, I got it, sorry. Here we go. So believe it or not, this is difficult to see, and this is why I said that it's difficult for us to judge based on color. This is what Brent was looking at. That very strange nose cap that when the giant legless snake takes on that black gloss in the dark is not very easy to see. But you can sort of see the difference in the shape of the face. And then if you look at the body size completely, you can get an idea. They're very, now what you're looking for as well is quite a thick snake-like shape. They're not snakes, they are legless burrowing skinks, so related to the lizard family. And this is where the evolution of reptiles gets very interesting, because as we know, snakes, and I mean, how much does that look like a snake? As we know, snakes used to have legs. If you look at some of the older species, such as a python, you'll be able to see the residual legs, the little caudal stumps that sit right close to the tail. And that is where the residue of their legs is gone. Interesting. I mean, can you imagine? I think we can finish off with that book for now. Can you just imagine being the first biologist that went to, or the first herpetologist that actually said, guys, this isn't a snake. This is a lizard, or a type of lizard. This is a skink. Somehow I can imagine him being laughed out of the herpetologist symposium. Maybe I've just got a very skewed view of how such things work, but that's what's in my head. And I've been listening to the Game Drive channel. Unfortunately, our lovely lions wandered straight off the property. From the time we heard them calling next to the dam, right up until now, they've gone south. So moving at high speed. And that was, I know that when we stopped outside our camp the first time, when we realized that despite all of our best wishes, our signal was not going to come up, or our picture was not going to come up. I heard lions calling far to the south. So it looks like two sets of tracks of the Birmingham boys responding to the vocalizations that I heard far to the south in that area. Brent has tracked them all the way down to Twin Dams. It's one of those things when you're tracking where you're just that little bit further behind the animal and they've gone south across the boundary. It doesn't mean that there aren't other lions on the property, though. I'm sure we heard vocalizations to the north, so I'm sure that Brent will be checking there next. I will try and help him out as much as I possibly can. Now, just to let you know, our elephant, responsible for the crushed fence, wandering slowly, ponderously down this road. And I can tell you what he did, and the reason I can tell you what he did and where he went was because I met him last night, so did Brent, and in fact, so did Eugene. Eugene to the point that the poor guy had to go all the way around the other side of quarantine, faced with a roadblock in the dark. And it seems as though it is our gentleman friend with the piercing in his ear. Totally ignored both of us, both Brent and myself, as we drove past in the dark. Wasn't interested in us at all. An interesting little side note about his behavior and the way that he responds to vehicles. Which I think emphasizes the point that, well, my opinion, that a lot of what he does in terms of approaching the vehicles is to relieve boredom. There you go, Marilyn, watching in Montana. It was indeed our hole-in-the-ear elephant friend. This sort of level of destruction was not him at all. This has come from... Oh, is our subtle stopping sound. This has come from elephants stripping away marula bark and allowing for borer beetles and other insects to attack the tree, eventually resulting in the tree's death. Now, I have a curious feeling that this purple roller might be nesting in this tree. Don't fly, don't fly, it's okay. Please don't fly away. Oh, oh. Birds and wings, man, birds and wings. You see him there, Dave. He's on top of the other dead marula tree that hasn't quite got to the stage of falling to pieces. I've seen this purple roller every single day on quarantine, and he or she has either been nesting in the is nesting in one of the marula trees around here, or possibly even one of the fallen stumps. So that is a purple roller. We'll start trying to. I have an idea. Why don't we see how many different species we can find in terms of reptiles, insects, and birds on quarantine? What do you think, Dave? We're up to the challenge. Let's do it. Let's stay exactly within signal range and find how many things we can find. Luckily for us, it is a beautiful, clear day. The sun is slowly rising, and we'll be able to see the birds as they start to wake up. Good morning, Olive and Emma. Olive and Emma are 5 years old and watching in Indiana, and they would like to know if I think that we might see elephants today. Well, Olive and Emma, I'm always on the lookout for elephants. Elephants are one of my favorite animals to see, and I think it's safe to say that they are probably one of your favorite animals as well. There've been lots of elephants yesterday afternoon. We had a whole herd around the car, so we'll keep our eyes peeled. Let's keep searching as well for our big boy that pushed the fence over, and we'll see if we can't find you some elephants. Who knows, we might even find some elephants. They might be included on our macro fauna list in terms of the wonders of quarantine. Shall we go and explore some more and find some more birds? Maybe we should challenge Brent to a bird competition on quarantine. Cheryl, having chatted a little bit, I am of course joking. We definitely won't be doing that to any of you. Cheryl, yes, the fence will be repaired right away. It's not a problem. It's not a disaster. It is one of those things that happens in the bush. At the moment where Brent and myself and Eugene are living, we don't have a fence at all. They've taken down the old fence after an elephant walked across that as well. And in fact, it's just one of those things that's going to happen more frequently with the drought. And any landowner, any reserve manager, anybody living in the bush knows that inevitably, excuse me, at some point, an elephant is going to push over your fence. And in fact, at some point, an elephant is going to walk into your garden and push over your favorite tree. I had a very interesting experience where I used to work. Now, we didn't have fences at all. We had a strip of wire that was sort of roughly elephant head height, and that had some metal sheets attached to it just around the camp. And that was a way of, it just made a noise. I wonder what little birds are not playing nicely for the camera. It had a sort of a wire flap that would make a noise and scare away the elephants. Now this way it worked perfectly for the breeding herds. Or possibly not, but we'll go with that. So interestingly, throughout the world, the dove is a symbol of peace. You release doves at weddings as a symbol of love. I remember very vividly as a kid getting a t-shirt when the first 94 democratic elections occurred in South Africa, getting the t-shirt with the two doves flying off together, all as a symbol of change and peace in the country. Now, what's interesting is that the local customs have the exact opposite perception. The dove is actually almost always a symbol of conflict, even war, and bloodshed. And the reason behind that is that the males can fight each other surprisingly fiercely for access to the female. And this particular instance, the pair that we're watching, that's the female trotting about in front. Behind her is the male. And up until he got distracted about a second ago, he is actually attempting to court. He's got that puffed out chest. Ah, come on, boy, you were doing it so nicely just a moment ago. He was stalking her with a puffed out chest and every impression that his intentions were to... You get the idea. But he's been totally distracted by breakfast. Now, Gloria's friend Ryan is a new viewer and was wondering, just to go back to our snake, or our legless skink actually, before we chat too much about my elephant story. Now, Gloria's friend Ryan was wondering, in evolutionary wise, did the snakes evolve from legged creatures? And the answer is absolutely, and I'm going to find you a perfect example here. If you bear with me for 1 second, I'm really hoping we've got a nice example. Let me see if I can find it. Sometimes they have it very clearly on in these pictures. Not so clearly. I'm looking at the African rock python. And we're going to look away. Sorry, Dave. We're actually going to look away from the African rock python so that Jamie can dig in her box for the actual snake book and not the reptile book. Oh, start again. And we shall find the pythons. Sorry, this is quite a nice, easy answer to the question. They did indeed evolve from legged creatures, and some of the more sort of the older snakes in their reptilian world, such as pythons, and in fact, I think Burmese pythons as well as the African rock pythons. We of course don't have Burmese pythons, and doesn't have it. I'm quite surprised by that. That's a pity. I'm quite disappointed because it's such a nice way of telling the difference between male and female pythons. Anyway, so at the back of a python, at the back of the python, towards the cloaca, so the reproductive opening in both male and female snakes, as well as the excretory opening, they share that sort of common tract, there are two protrusions that are about this long in a 2 meter specimen. Very, quite thick and very solid, almost like spurs. And those are the remnants of their legs. And I think they are known as caudal extensions or caudal somethings. And they stick out at the back. Now in males, male pythons, those are a little bit longer. And now at this point, they serve a very rudimentary grasping function when the snakes are mating. So it allows the male to hold onto the female slightly better. I'll have a look, I'll see if I can find a picture for you at some point and I'll just be able to share it with you. But yes, from what scientists understand, evolutionary-wise, snakes evolved from creatures with legs. And isn't it fascinating that evolution for them went in that direction where legs are no longer necessary? We tend to think of reptiles as supremely unevolved animals. And that's not the case at all. They are just totally different from our understanding of mammals and birds. It's just one of those interesting factors. They've evolved perfectly for what they are intended to do. Yes, they're slow, they're exothermic, so their body temperature is controlled by external factors. That also means they need to eat less, they need to eat far less than a mammal or a bird in order to maintain the speed of their metabolism. It's just one of those things, it's a trade-off. You can't really think of it as one or another. I haven't forgotten my elephant story, but as it is, a quarantine is so filled with thrilling things, I just don't know where to look. We'll start. How's that view for you, Dave? Can you see in there? With how much termite activity has been happening over the last few days because of the damp and cool weather, which we are all exceptionally grateful for. Now you see all of that fresh work around the termite mound, and if you look really closely, you can see the little workers. Still busy, busy. Hasn't got too hot for them yet. That fresh mud packed all around the top. Now that pale color of those termite workers tells us specifically that they are nocturnal or cool weather animals. They do not work well in the sun. Now, if we go out a little bit, I'm actually going to jump out. Keep my legs stretched and limber. You never know when you might need to. Oh, here we go. So this is actually almost a completely new termite mound. Let me do something quickly, sorry. Something I keep forgetting to do, but that I must remember to do. Here we go. Here we go. This entire mound actually is almost completely new. You can see how damp the dirt is around it. That being said, you can see quite clearly where the new compacted soil has been added. And if I put my hand here, it's warm. There's warm air coming up out of it. That's more noticeable in winter. And in fact, very often, if you come past in winter, you'll find animals like yellow-billed hornbills sitting right on top of the termite mound vents, allowing the warm air that's coming up from underground to heat them up, at the same time enjoying a snack. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to breathe ever so gently on the termites. I'm not going to scare them too much. I just want to see if maybe some soldiers might respond to my carbon dioxide. So as you can see, they're still around, but I just want to see if that brings out any of the soldier termites. You get a really good idea of the difference in size. Anybody coming up? Important to note what I'm doing at the moment. Be aware of doing this. So I'm looking in because I know it's safe, because I can see all of the termites out and about, but don't do this with an empty termite mound, because what likes nice, warm, sort of enclosed spaces? And the answer to that is snakes. So be careful of sticking your hand or your head down into a termite mound like this. No soldiers coming up, fair enough. I guess my carbon dioxide wasn't enough to bring them out of their morning slumber. I will leave them be for now. So they respond to two things, soldiers. They respond to the pheromones of the workers, and they respond to the carbon dioxide of potential predators, for example, an aardvark. Here we go. Birds. Birds, Dave, can we get that falcon? And the bee eaters. Why am I seeing all of the birds now? That's so unfair. Here we go, I'm plugged back into the outside world. Once again, very well done, Dave. Not sure at one glance which falcon that is. It is totally amazing, Arbeard, before we move on from our termite mound, it really is amazing how the huge mounds actually start to come into existence. And this is such a new little mound. Maybe a newly established colony, although I don't think that's happened quite as fast. But this is building of the last week or so. And it'll be part of the same colony of those mounds as well. And those are fairly well established. And then, of course, most of it all underground. Just like the tip of an iceberg, we're only seeing part of the termite mounds colony. Angie just read my mind. Angie would like to know, what are all of the tracks in front of the car? Got nice, really clear examples here of the tracks that Angie was talking about. Angie, perhaps we should put it to you guys as a quiz, but I'll go with this one because it should be fairly easy and quick. I'll just tell you exactly what it is. If we look down at the shape of the tracks, do those remind you of horse tracks? You can only see one toe. So that's a lot of animals of the same species trotting along the road together. And they're moving relatively quickly. It's a trot because of the way that the hooves have dug into the dirt. It's not a walk, it is a trot. Of course, that gives it away straight away. If it's a horse-like track that is trotting, we immediately know that it's a herd of zebra. So, Angie, it's a herd of zebra that's moving across the road. We've also got some very washed-out tracks on either side, mostly of impala, a couple of old wildebeest tracks around here. But I'd rather show you those with nice, clear examples, so that's what we'll do as well. We'll check quarantine, see if we can't find some nice antelope tracks for you. And strangely enough, when Renius came to do our tracking lessons, it was the antelope tracks that really caught me out. Dacre, Nyala, Kudu, because sometimes you get a young kudu and it's the same shape and size as a Nyala track, and Bushbuck and Steenbok, and it's surprisingly difficult, and I was surprisingly rusty when it comes to antelopes, just because you generally don't track antelope species. Now, for the most part, I think most of our viewers know by now that I'm not terribly squeamish when it comes to different insect types and most of the animal species, actually. But Bad Llama would like to know on YouTube that, well, since Indiana Jones has a particular dislike of snakes, I'm wondering what my particular dislike is, if there are any animal species that I don't particularly get on with. And it's something that I'm almost ashamed of in my own way, and it's not snakes, and it's not spiders, and it's not scorpions. Bad Llama, if I'm completely honest, and we'll have to kind of think about keeping this a bit of a secret between all of us, if that is possible. I'm getting quite a visceral reaction to centipedes. I don't know what it is, not millipedes. Millipedes I love. I'm quite happy to let a millipede crawl all over me. Centipedes, of course, are venomous. So there is at least part rational reason for my intense reaction to them. But I don't know what it is. I just don't like centipedes at all. I think it comes from, as a kid, horror stories from my aunt about her time spent living in Singapore and the giant centipede she used to find in the house. And obviously my imagination played an enormous role in providing probably an excessive amount of detail in that respect, and thus I became not afraid of centipedes. I just would far rather somebody else remove them from my shoe, thank you very much. I also did a sleep out once with a group of guests on a deck over a river, and we were sitting quite high up on the bank of the river around the fire. I'd been sitting on a log on the tree there, Dave. All the birds are feeling far too energetic. It's now sitting in front of that dead tree on top of the branch there. There we go. Perfect. Little birds that hardly ever sit still. Little bee eaters. My personal favorite bee eater, also known as the springbok bird, is named for the rugby colors, or our rugby team's colors, and the way in which they duck down and then dart back up again. Aren't they beautiful? The smallest bee eater species here, and a non-migratory species, so one we can see all year round. Absolutely stunning. Probably about half the size of the European or the white-throated bee eaters that we see fairly commonly. And always together in these little groups. Bee eaters being very sociable birds. And one thing I've noticed is that the European bee eaters are starting to fly. They're starting to migrate already in their huge flocks. Luckily, our little bee eaters will be here to entertain us all year round once our European bee eaters head to the north. And that's wonderful news. Because, of course, we do spend a lot of time. Sometimes the animals are a no-show. Sometimes they go for a walk across the boundary. And it's also really important to foster a love of not just the big five and the high-profile animals. Oh, the flies are out. The flies are back. I can see Dave frantically waving his hands in the air. But yes, it's important to foster a love of all of the animals, not flies though. No, not the flies. I get that they serve their purpose, but I don't love them right now. They keep flying into my ears and into my eyes and into my nose. I wouldn't say that I love them. But it is important to foster at least an understanding of the way in which the different animal species work. And Pamela was just saying that she can't explain... Oh, sorry, Patricia was just saying that she can't explain it, but it is the way that... Since watching Safari Live, she now listens to all of the birds in her garden and can identify the differences between each and every call. And that's perfect. That's exactly what we want to do. We want to not just foster love of the African nature and bushveld, but also give you the ability to... I'm trying to think exactly what I'm trying to say. It's almost like give you the... A slightly deeper understanding of what's happening in terms of nature around you. And I think that the way in which, and I was raised in a city, I think that the way in which city life works, and in fact most life these days, urbanized life works, is that you are very disconnected from what's going on around you. But Patricia, since I started working in the bush, I find myself spending more and more time outside in my garden at home, or in my parents' garden at home in Johannesburg, listening to the different bird calls, and I've heard far more than I ever thought I would absorb as a child. I know exactly what you mean, and I've done exactly the same thing since living in the bush. It's a brilliant thing. Megan, I'm actually going to stop here for this question. And hopefully we might even get a little bit of a demonstration from our friend. He's back in, you got him there, Dave, back in exactly the same, almost exactly the same place. Where is he? There he is, in the middle of your screen. Oh, okay. This might be an almost impossible task. They keep flying between. The little fiends are dashing around. He's there in front of us on the fallen acacia. And actually bashing his beak, or was bashing his beak, on the tree itself. And I think he caught something. Look how beautiful he is. Look how it blends into the grass. It's amazing. Now, it's less pronounced in the little bee eater, but it is very, very clear in the larger bee eater species. Have a look at that long, thin beak whenever this little bird turns its head. Be able to see the answer to the question about how do bee eaters eat bees without getting stung. The answer is they snatch them out of the air at the tip of their beaks, they land on a suitable tree branch, such as this, and they proceed to bash the bee or wasp against the side of the tree or the bark until they've first of all ended its life, but also second of all scraped away the sting. So they use that beak almost as a pair of tweezers to hold it away from their body, much as I do whenever I'm catching a centipede. And that's the way that they are specially adapted. And that forked tail, also for providing considerable agility, as they've just demonstrated. Katrina, this is a little bee eater, and it's my personal favorite bee eater species, and one of the ones that we don't always get to get on camera, because they keep dashing off and then returning. But look how it likes that perch. Isn't that interesting? Patricia, it is a little bee eater. So the smallest one that we get in this area. As I said, my favorite. Haven't seen the carmine bee eaters in a while. We can just have a look at the different types that we might see here. Lots of different bee eater species. We'll just go through them very rapidly. So to start with, the southern carmine bee eater, a beautiful bee eater that is probably about double, if not more, than the size of our little bee eater in front of us. Look at that. You can see now what I mean with the larger birds, that very, very long beak. as I get to sort of start to turn, just keep an eye on all the different bee eater species of Africa. There is our little bee eater. That's the one we're looking at the moment. Tiny, tiny, with a beautifully forked tail and those springbok rugby colours, which I feel obliged to emphasise as a South African. And then, where else are we? Let's go to the white-fronted next, also a permanent resident all year round. You see lots of those in Kruger. Might even see, although I think you'd find us getting very, very excited, a blue-cheeked bee-eater, which is just below that. How many of you have seen a blue-cheeked bee-eater on live? I'm not sure there can be that many of you. In fact, I'd love to know how many of you have a blue-cheeked bee-eater on your live bird list. They're quite unusual in this area. Then the European down at the bottom, we're almost done. European bee eater, lots of different vibrant colours, and as I said, most of them starting to wander off now, further to the north. And thus ends our bee eater lesson of the morning. Quarantine, as always, providing us with plenty of exciting life to keep us busy. In the meantime, though, it seems as though Wendy's gremlins have been fought off, and Brent is back out on the road, so let's find out what his plans are for the morning.
So fortunately, the tech team was standing by as we got there, and hopefully the gremlins stay away. It seems like they choose to invade different vehicles on different days, but I know Jamie gave a very good explanation of the life cycle of a gremlin recently. So I'm not going to harp on them anymore. Unfortunately, those lions that VM and I were tracking crossed to the south of us, and we did get outside the area. So I've had a report that the Nkuma's crossed in and crossed out, but we're going to double check that far west. Gonna see what area Jamie is working. Jamie.
I think perhaps I spoke too soon, and unfortunately, Brent has vanished off your screens once again. I'll just let him know we were in the middle of having a conversation, so I'll just finish that off. Copy that. I will possibly attempt Zoe's Road at some point. Being brave here, thinking about Zoe's Road. Dave was in the middle of restrapping our camera, so we'll just try to stop for you, Dave. Sure, no problem. At the moment, I can see it sort of doing this, so he's just going to restrap it on. In the meantime, I'll tell you my elephant story, since we are currently sitting here and there's no birds around me and nothing else I can distract myself with. So I was talking about the elephant wire around the camp fence and the fact that it generally deterred the breeding herds, but it didn't really work that well on the male elephants, particularly since at one point we had to have it high enough that game drive vehicles could drive under it. Otherwise, you sort of run the risk of decapitating your guests on the back, which generally is not going to get you any positive reviews as a safari company. So the elephants' balls used to walk right in. I spent every Christmas there working, and what we'd do is we would decorate a fever tree being a beautiful greenish-yellow acacia that has the most exquisite bark, and it makes for a really decorative Christmas tree, and of course those perfect thorns make nice positioning for the baubles, and we could wrap tinsel around it, and we had a great game as to who could invent a way of getting the bauble highest on the fever tree. Oh, the fun we used to, or the ways we used to find to entertain ourselves. Oh, an elephant came in and pushed my fever tree over. And we managed to pull it back upright, and we managed to prop it up. And I went out on sleep out and I came back and that same bull had not only pushed over my fever tree so that it was bent double, but he'd actually stripped away most of the bark. Now, in absolute desperation, because I refused to admit that this fever tree was probably going to die, it was such a beautiful, ornamental, pretty tree, with two vehicles with tow ropes on either side, pulling backwards in opposite directions to pull the fever tree upright, which we did manage, but not before that fever tree actually, and I mean, it was not a large fever tree, it was about this large, actually managed to pull one, when we tried it with one vehicle, actually managed to lift the entire back of the car and reposition it in a totally different place. And we had some nice, beautiful skid marks across the well-tended lawn. That didn't make me very popular. Anyway, we got the three beaver tree up, and we got the prop, we got a nice prop underneath, and now I'm faced with this desperate situation, because now I can see the bark is stripped away. There's a thin strip that I think maybe, just maybe, the tree is going to survive, just like marula trees can sometimes survive with that strip of bark showing. But I know about borer beetles and I know about trees losing moisture through the stripped bark. So I frantically rushed into the kitchen and I got plastic wrap or cling wrap. And I wrapped it, I basically bandaged this tree all the way up and all the way down. I almost used up an entire roll of cling wrap. That also made me very popular, by the way. And I sort of tried to pour water down it and I didn't have any spray or anything like that to try and protect it from borer beetles. I just had to make a bush plan. Now, I would love to tell you, well done, Dave. I would love to tell you that the end point of the story is that the fever tree recovered and lived many happy, happy years afterwards. And it didn't, though, it died. And I refused to accept it for a very long time. And the longer I refused to accept it, the more my boss said to me, listen, you've got to cut this thing down. So eventually, after it slowly started drooping further and further into the path, and it eventually became a risk to people's eyes, since a lot of people tend to walk around without really looking where they're going, and including myself, I'm not discluding myself from that list, and the people kept poking themselves in the forehead, and we were worried about eyes. So eventually my boss said to me, you really need to cut that down now. And so it was with great ceremony and great devastation that I took a saw to my favorite fever tree, sawed it over, and then spent the rest of the afternoon raking up all the thorns that were on the lawn and the path. So it just goes to show, elephants in the camp, that's just how things go. Now, the baobab, on the other hand, the baobab we defended with our lives. we desperately have chased elephants away from the young baobab tree so many times in the camp. Bird feeding party. Oh. Listen, birds, I can't go that far, so please stop flying away. Judy, that's a really good point. Judy would like to consider beehives. It's something that Africa has been used and put forward as a suggestion to keep elephants away from crop fields further north in Africa. And it seems to be something that's working really well. And in fact, I have the viewers of Safari Live to thank for that little tidbit of information, because I did not know that at all before I started working here. Let's just have a look at this hornbill. It seems to have something in it. It either has... Ah, oh, right. I'm just going to stop saying that now. Sorry, Dave. Is it something we've considered? No. Just because up until this point, the elephants haven't really been an issue in terms of coming into the camp, and I don't think they're going to be as big of an issue as they are in places in Africa where they do utilize that system. The bees buzzing and the presence of the bees seems to work really well in terms of keeping elephants out. We never know. We might find if this problem persists, we have a solution. There's other things that have been attempted as well. Protecting large trees, I know that we've spoken about this. The large trees up on quarantine clearing have tin cans nailed to them as a way of preventing elephants from going to push them over. I'm not quite sure how, personally, we'll have to wait and see how effective that is going to be. I have a couple of doubts, possibly. And Maggie, yes, the hyenas. I was just thinking about the hyenas, actually. I was considering them as a possibility, but I'm not entirely sure I can get there without disappearing from your screens. Okay, we're gonna give it a go. We're going to try it. Everybody hold on to your seats. We're going to try and go into the den. We're going to try and go relatively slowly. We'll at least give us some wonderful things to look at, and I think we have signal there. Maggie, the hyenas have moved their hyena den, and it's something that fascinates me, and I've been trying to work out if it's a coincidence or if there's a connection to it. And that is the fact that whenever they've gone, okay, the two times that they have been at the Aubrey's Road den site itself, they've moved those dens very rapidly, but in a very small confined area. So last time they denned at the Aubrey's Road den site, they'd moved within 2 days to a different termite mound about 100 meters away. And that's exactly what they've done this time around. And I can't work out if it's a coincidence, if it's just because there are a convenient number of appropriate den sites in the area, or if there's a particular reason why the Aubrey's Road den sites are only habitable for a shorter time. Because if we look at how long, or I have another suggestion, and I don't think we'll ever have the answer to this, or is it the age of the cubs? I'm not going to stop for these birds. They keep flying, fluttering away. Or is it to do with the age of the cubs? And why I say that is, look how long they've stayed at the Galago shortcut den, the Mvubu Road den, and initially last year, the Philemon's Cutline den. A couple of, I would say, what, 2 weeks, 3 weeks at a time before moving? Whereas the Aubrey's Road den, it's a couple of days, couple of days, couple of days. Sometimes even longer. But they've always been very young cubs. And in fact, they seem to be following almost exactly the same rotation. Very young cubs at Philemon's, fairly young cubs at Galago Shortcut. Admittedly, we haven't found them before when they've used that Mvubu Road den, but that doesn't mean that they didn't use it the last time. And then across to Aubrey's Road. And by the time they get to Aubrey's Road, last year, June, was about the same age, if I remember correctly, as November is now. For those of you who are up to date with our hyena cubs, at about sort of 4 or 5 months. And maybe that's what prompts the rapid movement from den to den at Aubrey's Road. Because maybe the little cubs are getting more and more adventurous and moving further from the den site and actually finding a place where they feel a bit more comfortable. Or maybe they're just exploring and the adults are kind of putting up with their adolescent explorations. Just a theory. I have no idea if there's any truth to that or not. Just an observation. Don't you dare. Stay exactly where you are. Hello, beautiful. Yummy. Termites. Excuse me, sorry, I've got a terrible tickle in my throat. He's after, maybe I breathed in a termite when I was down at that termite mound. Now the birds all taking advantage of the termites being out. There's even a Franklin who's just arrived as well on the scene. Hear them chirping away. Is this one going to respond to the calls of the others? Yep. They look quite funny when they do that. Oh! What are you chasing hornbills for, you bully? Who would have guessed that a Franklin could be so aggressive? You're not even after the termites. That's not very nice at all. Interesting. I wonder what prompts that sort of confrontation between bird species. That Franklin is not in competition with the hornbill. It's after seeds and grass. Not termites. There's no competition. It was just an invasion of personal space. It was like, well, I'm the king of the castle. Well, actually, I think I want to move on now. Luckily, our hornbill not terribly deterred. Because when it comes down to it, in terms of flight, the Franklins are not exactly the world experts in flying. They're a bit heavy and bulky, as the hornbill's much more suitable for it. Look at the way he's digging down into the dirt, right up to almost the base of his beak. There, he got one. He got one. I'm not even sure that he's looking for termites. Look, I don't even sure that was a termite. No, it's definitely termites. It's the soldier termites. Turning his head to the side in order to spot them. Oh, time to move on to the next one. A red-billed hornbill. Oh, it's a combination of... All he's doing at the moment is I think he is listening for the sound of the termites scurrying underneath. That's how he's deciding where to go. Listening and looking. And then also he's got very sensitive nostrils and nerve cells around the base of his beak. So all of that acting in combination to help him find the termites. He hasn't been as fortunate as he was just there. Oh, there we go, found another one. Stabbing away at the dirt. And I guess this must be really nice weather as well for the hornbills, because the dirt is nice and soft. So it's easier for them to dig deep. Plus the termite mounds have all been freshly added to and it hasn't had time to set. And back again. Must be interesting. The termites probably aren't terribly bothered with his intrusion, apart from the ones that have just been eaten, of course. They'll be rather put out in their morning. It's not like having an aardvark digging into the termite mound and absorbing or eating large numbers of termites. He's basically just picking out one or two at a time. I doubt they're going to send a mass force to go and attack him and defend themselves. But if they did, he is definitely keeping them guessing in terms of where he's going to attack next. I always feel as though they look a little bit like they're wearing pantaloons. In a really old-fashioned way, the hornbills. We've just been listening to the crested Franklin's squeaking away, and Katrina says it actually reminds her of a dog's squeaky toy. I couldn't agree with you more. It sounds exactly like my dog chewing on a squeaky ball. Chugga-chugga, chugga-chugga. Having a long, very loud conversation with each other. Almost like they're shouting to each other across a marketplace. All right, our hornbill has finished off with his termite mound meal, despite the intrusion of the neighborhood bullies. Let us make our way towards the hyena den. There we go. We'll just have a last look at him as he cleans his beak, because it is quite interesting. He's not bashing any insects. He's cleaning the dirt off his bill. Yeah, very cool. Give it another go. Yep. Good clean. Try and get the dirt around and out of his nostrils. They always look... To me, their facial expression is always slightly manic. I don't know if that's my imagination or because the closest I tend to get to hornbills is when they're trying to bash their reflection in my bedroom window. They look a little bit like there's several personalities chatting at one time there in one individual bird. Anyway, moving on, Eric. As our hornbill flies away. You were wondering if hornbills have reinforced skulls in the same way that woodpeckers do. And as far as I know, not really. They tend not to spend as much time slamming. I can totally see where your point is coming from, just watching him peck into the dirt. But they tend not to do it on a surface that is much more solid than what we witness now. Now that sand's nice and soft, giving that hornbill an advantage now. But I doubt that they are in any way reinforced. They don't have to go and tap on hard bark and wood in the same way that... Sorry, I keep getting distracted this morning. There's a baby squirrel But there's a baby squirrel in a hole, and I don't know that it's going to come out. There you go. How cute is that? Yay, it came out. I think it came out because it's feeling all cold and fluffy. Oh, and disappeared. Just a very brief view of a young squirrel that's been living in this hollowed out silver cluster leaf. Sweet, I'm glad that worked. I see you. That's our last view of our baby squirrel. Eric, I think if we see a woodpecker, we'll go into a bit more detail about the reinforced skull and the way that their tongues wrap around their brain, believe it or not. It's one of my amazing woodpecker facts. It still boggles my mind. But for now, Nick, who is a new viewer, was wondering, he's heard us refer to the Big Five, and I've probably heard it with reference to Africa multiple times, and was wondering a little bit about where that term actually comes from. Nick, it originated, it is no longer used in reserves in the same sense. It originated with the five most dangerous animals in Africa to hunt, the five most difficult animals. And thus, on the list, you have the elephant, you have the rhino, lion, leopard, and buffalo. Those are the Big Five. Now we see the Big Four out here as a result of the current situation with rhino poaching. We don't show rhino, we do talk about them, but we don't show any signs of rhino. We do not put them on screen. Not just because we don't want to give any assistance to possible poachers, but also because it is very much a statement talking out against rhino poaching and our feelings on that subject. But we see one of the Big Four probably every drive, should at least see buffalo or elephant. Lion, for example, we had yesterday, we had elephants yesterday, we had buffalo yesterday. So we usually see one of the Big Five regularly. So as I said, it was a term that originated with where safaris were hunting safaris, and those were the most sought after and dangerous animals. It is no longer the way in which they described, but it is a term that is stuck, and it's usually one of the animals that people come to Africa most excited to see. Now I actually, land snail, playing it dangerous there, hiding behind a pile of elephant dung. Now I actually prefer to use the term high-profile animals, animals that we think of as high-profile. So that includes the five that I talked about, also includes cheetah, wild dog, and to me, quite honestly, hyena I think belong equally in terms of my wish list of what I would like to see. Now, there's lots of different ways of referring to them, and it's taken on its own meaning in that there's the Big Five birds, and there are the secret seven animals that are difficult to see. And I think it's called the Impossible Five. There's so many different ones that have now evolved from there that mean different things. The Little Five, which includes a rhino beetle, an ant lion, tiny, tiny little ant lion larvae, a leopard tortoise, an elephant shrew. Now, I promise you, if I see an elephant shrew on one of these drives, I'm going to be more excited than I have ever been. Elephant shrew. And a buffalo weaver, Red Bull buffalo weaver. Most of those we also see on a fairly regular basis. So Nick, that is what where the term originates. It's something that is no longer really used in any great serious sense, which I completely approve of. And it's more come to be a conservation term than anything else. Isn't it interesting though how historically that term has stuck with us in such a big way worldwide? But a warm welcome to you, Nick. I hope you are enjoying our live safaris. I'm sure you will be as hooked as most of our regular viewers are. Stuck around this tree. So this entire block is the Aubrey's Road block that I've been referring to. And just looking at it now, I can see all of the old two tracks from where when they first started denning in this area where I was entering to get to the different den sites. And it's amazing the way that this has worked. Oh, and we might be seeing elephants as well, so just keep your eyes peeled. Their tracks are all over the road. Walking up in the direction that we're driving. Here's an interesting question on the subject of elephants. Gloria and Gloria's husband, Gary, actually, would like to know, how long does an adult elephant's trunk get? Now, the fascinating thing about that is because it has an accordion effect, there's actually no real set measurement. So what I mean by that is they can stretch it forward or they can contract it inwards like an accordion. That's the way that their muscular structure works. Now, if I had to guess at a good sort of estimate of length, Gary and Gloria, I'm going to try and give you a range, and I'm going to try and convert that. So let's say at the longest stretch, it could probably reach about 2.5 meters, and it probably at its sort of shortest length, no, that's a slide. Let's say at its shortest length, it's about 2 meters, and at its furthest stretch, it's about 3. So between, I've forgotten how maths works, sorry, give me one moment. Between 6 feet to 9 feet, roughly, as a very sort of rough guideline, would be my guess as to an adult elephant's trunk. You'll probably find that in the bull elephants, they can stretch their trunk out even further. And in fact, despite the presence of the world's tallest land mammal, the giraffe in Africa, there is no animal capable of reaching a higher feeding height than an elephant. Because, of course, they are capable, first of all, of standing on their hind legs and balancing on their hind legs and then reaching their trunk up much higher than even a male giraffe could reach up. A little interesting fact for the day. If you've ever seen an elephant determined to reach a piece of fruit or a particular branch that they really want, they will go to any measure to get it. Now, elephants are not clumsy creatures. They are very much well coordinated. And anyone who says that elephants can't climb up rocks are wrong. I have found elephant dung on the top of koppies. Sorry, excuse me. I think I've choked on a fly. There's the gentle scent of a hyena den. Unfortunately, from what I can see, no sign of the hyena cubs. Let's go and see if any of them decide to pop out of curiosity. Please don't tell me they've moved again. That would be getting ridiculous. They've only just arrived here. More than possible, of course, that the adults are just out and about. And therefore, the cubs doing what cubs do, which is sleeping in the termite mound. Nice setup they've got going here. I hope they haven't moved again. Nope. No curious ears popping out. And speaking of cubs and on the subject of little spotted animals, but a slightly different little spotted animal, Siberia Zumi, you've said that you haven't seen a leopard in a while, and to be completely honest, neither have I. But you were wondering if we have any update on Karula. Now, for those of you joining us, like Nick for the first time, and we're wondering about who Karula is, she is known as the Queen of Juma. She is a leopardess that has made Juma, where we are now, the center or the heart of her territory. Now, she's recently had cubs. They were born around the beginning of February. I think it was the 2nd or so of February. And as such, we've been giving her plenty of space in order to look after those tiny little cubs whilst they're still too young to be able to really be alert to the dangers around them or even climb up trees or out of the way. Now, Karuna made a very interesting decision, and that was to move her cubs into a drainage line, into a stormwater drain on a main road. I have no idea what prompted that particular decision on her part. She must have had her reasons. Maybe the constant passage of vehicles she felt actually made her cubs safer. I really don't know. I mean, it's an interesting question. So she was seen by several vehicles going past along that road, and the cubs looking happy and healthy. The only update I can give you for now is that she's moved further south, so south of our main boundary. I suspect, quite honestly, I suspect that it's connected to the presence of these hyenas. I think that's why she didn't den in her usual spot around the two lodges. Beyond that, I can't tell you anything. All of the guides giving her plenty of respect and space. So we don't have any updates for now. We'll just have to wait and see whether or not she decides, when she decides to wander back onto Juma. In the meantime, I'm going to back out of the hyena den, see what other wonderful things we can find in our signal area. And let's find out. Let's try once again to find out how Brent's morning is going.
So hopefully second time is a charm as we head out again. That is one of the things about being live and in the bush. Sometimes we do have a bit of technical difficulties, but fortunately we have our tech team on standby to try and help sort these things out. So now this is quite interesting. So there were tracks of the Nkuma pride coming in and then going out, but you never know, they might come back in again. And in this area, there's quite a lot of high-speed running tracks. These are particular ones of kudu trying to possibly escape. It's difficult to say for sure unless we see a lion track as well, but taking off, so let's keep our fingers crossed and hopefully we're going to find some animals. Yeah, a nice bird calling. Okay. Where are you going? I think he's going to land in the ivory tree. There somewhere. I can hear them. It's a red bull. The old name is the red-billed woodhoopoe. Current name is the greenwood hoopoe. Oh, I can hear a ground hornbill calling ahead of us. Doo 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 doo. Doo 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 doo. Maybe we'll get lucky enough to catch up with that ground hornbill. So we did see that incredible giant legless skink on earlier on. What do you spotted, VM? Ah, so there's the culprit from the tracks. Maybe they were just playing. They don't look like they've just been running away from lions. I'll get back to your question now, Rolf. Yeah, male kudu, there's a couple there. I can just see some movement behind that one. They might have been having we have seen the big kudu bulls playing before, chasing each other around and around. So that could have been what those tracks are. You can just see their horns through the bush there. At least three sets of horns I can see. And Rolf was wondering, do people in Africa eat reptiles? Or in South Africa particularly eat reptiles like they do in the other parts of the world? So a lot of cultures in southern Africa will not eat reptiles, although the Bushmen, they do, quite fond. I've actually eaten quite a few different types of snakes in my years out there, including a highly venomous puff adder. But one must remember, once the head is lobbed off, it is no longer venomous. And I would say the closest meat to describe it to in consistency is chicken. But let's go see if we can get close to those kudu. So, Rolf, in parts of Zambia, different tribes will eat snakes. But as a general rule, in a lot of Africa, but if you go into the Central African rainforests, snake is a big part of the diet. Now, see, there we go. So, in and out, in and out. So we are gonna check this area quite extensively. See, there we go. Lovely lioness tracks. So hopefully if their taxon said they crossed in, then they crossed out, maybe they crossed back in again. They have been doing quite a lot of that behavior recently, as they have been hunting through this particular area. There we go. But just judging from those kudu, I don't think those tracks were running from the lions. I think since they were very close to where we saw those running kudu tracks, we found the kudu. And hopefully we're gonna get a nice view of them now. Sort of works out quite well because the lioness tracks are also heading in this direction. So as I was saying, Rolf, about Central Africa, now, considered to be a delicacy is python, and is actually sometimes served at... The VM's got the lion tracks, I can see them there. Has actually eaten python at a presidential dinner. So it is considered a delicacy. It is a protected species in South Africa. He's gonna run now. It's considered royal game. So we've got some quite interesting legislature when it comes to wildlife that is left over from the colonial era, and certain species are considered royal game. And under royal game means you can only be hunted with express, very special permission. Oh, there you go. Off he goes. So, very interesting stuff. Kudu, on the other hand, although they are very regal, were not considered royal game. It was generally species you didn't come across too often. So things like python, suni, which is a tiny little antelope. Sorry, I think I just heard something for a second there. No. Leopard, lion were also considered royal game. But the real royal game was more interesting. It was like quite very specific species. So can't remember them all offhand. I'm just gonna get hold of Tax quickly while I show you this beautiful big... Oh no, he's also running. So maybe they were chased by lions earlier. That's why they're a bit jumpy now. Let's see, maybe he's gonna pass behind us. You're gonna come out into the open there, Vim? Doesn't look like it. Staying in the safety of the thickets. So I'm just gonna check on the game drive radio quickly to see where Tax had those tracks crossing out. Tax. Morning for those in Garland Corns, or where did you have them leaving Vuyatela? Copy, I've got another set, looks like two Onsati on Impala Road heading south. I'll follow up for a little bit. So what sounds like happened is they did come down here, and then they looped round like that and into Sibambili. But we will check just in case they decide to pop back across. And once I get closer to the western edge of our... I'll jump on the western channel, see if I can get an update for you. But so far, we've still got tracks. Listening. So there was a go-away bird giving a bit of a call there. I know. So sometimes they do alarm at predators, but it's a very specific call, and that call is not the one. Listening to a very pretty call. And we're going to see if we can find this bird for you. You can hear this wonderful call. I'm going to see if I can spot him now. I think I can see it flicking around. I'm just going to... Very pretty call. Oh, there he is. Let me go back. Beautiful little chirping going on here. Let's see. Let's jump to the next tree at the back there. I'm going to try a little birder's trick. Psst, 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 psst. There we go. See him, Vim?
I just always thought that.
Okay. There he is, coming closer to us. There we go. You got him. So he's going up. So come up a bit. And zoom and go a little to the right. A little bit more to the right, I think. Is that a snake or a millipede? It's a millipede there as well. I'm gonna just, he's just in a really bad spot for us. Okay. If we go forward a little bit, we might get a little window. I see him there now, Ben.
Yeah.
Okay.
Lost him again.
Okay.
Where is he going? He moved now.
Psh, 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 psh.
He's there, but he's behind the branch.
Do you want me to go forward or back?
A little bit forward.
Here we go. Beautiful, beautiful call. And this is one of the other robin species we get here. This is the white-browed scrub robin. Beautiful, beautiful call. And he's in a wonderful tree. It's actually been pushed over by eddies, unfortunately. But it is a low-fault or Transvaal saffron. And leaves do have a very saffron-like scent to them. You can definitely sit and listen to the robins for hours. Now, most of the robin species are great mimics, so they'll often copy other birds. There we go. Well, let's continue on our search for other things. Now, James in Ohio was wondering about male lion Jem, sorry, not. Territory sizes, are they bigger than the prides? Yes, Jem, are quite a bit bigger than the prides. They'll often encompass multiple prides areas. What tracks are those there, Jem? Is that a hyena? I think that's a hyena. Yeah, hyena. So Jem, a male lion, three, sometimes even four different prides are that their territory encompasses. A little bit more later.
Look who it is. It is our friendly black-bellied bustard. And dare we hope that today he's going to break his pattern and call for us. A little bit surprised by our sudden arrival. I'm fairly certain it's the same black-bellied bustard we saw yesterday. At the moment, all I can hear is the squeaky dog toy sounds of crested Franklins. But I do think I heard another black-bellied bustard calling. I'm hoping that this gentleman might respond in kind. Oh, nearly. He thought about it there. I just can't quite get that imitation right. I'm desperate to show some of our newer viewers what a black-bellied bustard call looks and sounds like. If you go behind that tree and call, I'll be terribly upset, black-bellied bustard. Puffing himself out. That was how I found him, actually. All puffed out like that. I think just flexing his muscles and his wings. Please call, boy. I hoped if I asked nicely, he might oblige. I don't think so. We're coming right to the end of their breeding season, so we'll be seeing them calling less and less. He's puffed up again. It is like he's thinking about it. No, he's just going to move really, really slowly. Like an Inyala might do. I wonder if there's not another one somewhere close to him that I haven't seen. That might explain his puffed up, almost rooster-like behavior. No, there he comes. They are really beautiful birds.
Good morning, all station.
Good morning. Turn you down a little bit. I love the way they walk. Head first and then head back. Head first and head back. It's almost like they're pulling themselves along with their heads. If that makes any sense. Like a mime. You know when mimes pretend to pull themselves along on a rope? That's sort of what he looks like he's doing. And he's slowly disappearing. I can't see another black-bellied bustard, female or male. Female's quite clearly distinguishable from the males. They don't have as much black running all the way up underneath their chins. Ooh, so puffed up. Even got to see the black underneath the neck there for a brief second. There again. He's doing that deliberately. I think there must be another black-bellied bustard that we can't see. Oh, food. If there is, it's not enough to distract him from a quick breakfast meal. Might have snatched up an insect. Maybe found a nice seed. There he goes again. Oh, plucking berries from the tree there. I wonder if that was... And there's some on the ground as well. Some kind of fruit. At this distance, I can't see exactly which tree that is.
Are you welcoming? Where are you going to work? after that?
Yeah, I'm on the Manuleti down there all the way. But the guys from...
That's brilliant news. Now, we always encourage new viewers to jump on board with us and start their own bird lists of the different birds that they see on Safari Live. And Marilyn in Montana has just let us know that between yesterday and today, she actually added 3 new bird species to her list, bringing her up to a total of, I think you said, 146, which is exceptionally impressive for this area. Some of the bird lists are coming along beautifully. And Marilyn has got a picture for each and every single bird on her bird list. That's fantastic news, Marilyn. I'm glad to hear that. I must say that it's one of my favorite parts of this sunset safari. It's like a treasure hunt, looking for the different bird species. And one day, I will get you all a southern boo-boo. Hey, Dave, we didn't manage the last time. We tried. We definitely tried. But unfortunately, no luck. We were sitting right next to the mating lions, and I was watching it jump in between the branches, and it just didn't quite manage it. Our black-bellied bustard has disappeared off into quite a thick block. I'm going to leave him to his morning breakfast and see if I can try and help Brent with his lion tracking in this limited area. And while I continue looking to see if the lions came this way, let's find out how Brent's trip down the western edge of Juma is going.
So, unfortunately, it looks like those lions did not cross back. And also, the gremlins are telling me where I should look for animals. So I'm going to listen to the gremlins. Maybe they're right. Maybe they're going to find us a leopard. So I'm going to move back down towards the center of Juma and see what we can find around here. Ooh. One of the hardest birds to get on camera, because they are just so minute. And I think they have escaped us again. I can hear them calling. High-pitched little zzzz of the blue waxbill. There he is, yeah.
We were looking for close.
Oh, there he goes, he flew. he's going to be too small to see in that tree. He is absolutely minute. A very cute little bird. Very, very pretty. Get you a picture of him now. Oh, there's one just landed. Oh, no, he's gone again. Oh, he's landed. Okay. See the fallen down tree of him?
Yeah, well.
Zoom now. Down to the right a bit. Right, just a little bit to the right. Hopping there. There he is. You can't really see him too well, but there's a little blue waxbill. Can you hear that little call? Zee-zoo-zoo. Are little grass eaters, so they'll be moving around feeding off all the different little grass species. And they've got this wonderful little sort of powder blue color to them, but they are minute. Very, very pretty little birds. Them and the firefinches are definitely two of the most challenging birds to get on the camera, but we will keep trying. I know a lot of you are keeping extensive bird lists now, so always great to be able to add another one to your bird lists. So I get as excited as you do. Chatting about lions quite a bit this morning, Aaron in New Zealand would like to know, is it true that one of the Majinga lions was killed by one of the Matimbas. Aaron, as far as I've heard the rumor, it's the opposite way around. One of the Matimbas has been killed by the Majinga lions. I cannot neither confirm nor deny. I haven't heard anything further. But I do know they had a big scrap, and one of the Matimbas did get quite badly injured, whether he expired from his injuries or not. So what happened, as far as I understand, the fight moved into the Sand River, where it'd be quite difficult to get a car in you unless you have a boat. So not sure what's happened there. As soon as you get any clarification, we will let you guys know. So, of course, with all these type of things, there are lots of rumors. I don't like to get involved in the gossip mongering. So as soon as I can have a definite answer for you, I'll let you know. So it does look like some weather is moving in now after that brilliant sunlight of the early morning. And it has been quite regular for the last 2 or 3 days that we've had a sort of midday downpour. So the weather being quite nice in terms of that, it seems to let us do our morning safaris and our evening safaris and just rain in the middle of the day. So, we have a question from a brand. Where this is really streaming live from South Africa. Vim, are we live?
I think
we're live. I'm not 100% sure. No, I'm only joking. Sandra, yes, we're coming to you live from the African bush in the beautiful Sabi Sands Game Reserve. And more particularly at the moment, we're on Juma Private Game Reserve. And lots of beautiful things out here, from the small creepy crawlies to the slithering snakes and skinks, all the way to the majestic male lion who is evading us this morning. What I'm doing now is I saw some elephant tracks there, so I'm going to try a loop around. I think they're going down towards the edge of quarantine. We're going to go see if we can find the biggest land mammal in the world, the African savanna elephant. It's amazing how the weather changed just like that. 4 minutes ago, we were in bright sunshine, and now we are in very overcast, cloudy, almost misty conditions. And that cloud bank seems to be getting lower and lower as we continue on this sunrise safari. Request from Marianne in Arkansas, and I have to stop the vehicle for this, and this is for all the new viewers. So I've been very fortunate in my upbringing. I've grown up in the bush, so when I was a little boy, to explain lion roars, my grandfather and my father used to tell my brother and myself a little story. So a lion roar sounds something like this. Oh, excuse me. Just gonna have a drink of water before I do the next one. So lions roar mostly to proclaim their territory and to make sure all the other lions know that this is their sort of zone. So to explain that, as when we were very young, sort of 4 or 5 years old, how my dad and my grandfather used to explain it to us, as the lion, male lion says, "Whose land is it? Whose land is it? It's mine. It's mine. It's mine." So there we go. It's for all the new viewers, but I know the old faithful do love it, so it's for everyone, and I'm being attacked by flies at the moment. So let's carry on. do hear a very beautiful bird calling. I think I've spotted it, Vim. I can just see him, okay. Go right up to the top of the center. And then come back left lightly. He's moved, just hopped. There's two of them, actually. Zoom, Vim, center screen. There we go. There he is. It is a black-headed oriole. And the orioles have that wonderful liquid chortle almost. You can hear him calling now. So we get a couple of different types of orioles. The black-headed, let's just see if he hops into a bit more of an open spot. We can try our birding trick again. Psh, 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 psh. He's high, safe, up in the tree, so he's not responding to my alarm calls. But they are very beautiful birds. They've got a very distinct black head and a golden body with a red beak and a very pronounced red eye. You think if I go backwards a bit, Ben?
You can try. No, he flew off.
He flew off.
Oh, yeah, maybe it's another one.
No, he's still there. I can see him. No, there. Oh, there we go. Okay. Zoom them. Okay, a little bit out of it. Slightly. Where's he gone now? I can see him with my eyes. No. Okay. So, okay. You see that branch? Okay, zoom in on that a little bit to the right. There. Okay, just keep the frame on there. I'm going to move the vehicle slightly. See if we get the view, whether it's backwards or forwards. There we go. I can just see the gold, I think. There's going to be a gap for his head shortly. There we go. So you can see that, there we go. You can see the gold and you can see the distinct black head. A bit far for us to see the red eye and the red beak. You can sort of make out the red beak. So if there are any new viewers out there, quite a lot of our viewers like to keep a list, or lists of all we see on the live safaris. And so if you are new, we encourage you to keep a bird list. Or a mammal list, or a flower list, or a list of anything we might find out here. So this is a black-headed oriole. Very beautiful call. Okay. So it's just because the view on there is not so good, let's have a quick look at the app so you can have a look when we hopefully will find one closer. It'll look something like this. There you go, very beautiful bird. Okay, so guys, we're gonna see what else we can find, and while we do that, let's jump back on board with my stalker, Jamie.
Going to speak very, very softly. I'm sitting here with a sighting that is exceptionally unusual on these live safaris, the two greatest species of primates. Oh, they're disappearing. Oh, they're escaping, they're escaping. I was going to chat to you about the way in which they behave and the mutualism demonstrated between the primate sitting in the front that is in control of the tool that they have mastered, and then the one sitting in the back operating the camera. It's a perfect example of mutualism operational in nature. So one cannot exist without the other, and they're both of benefit to each other. So the primate in the front controls where the primate in the back goes, but the primate in the back controls exactly what is seen in their overall overarching purpose. Well, it's a behavioral study that has gone on for many, many years. The way in which we operate. Now, we will find that neither of these, it has got to the point where these primates have developed such a reliance upon their tools that neither of them can function without signal. And in fact, the reason that we found them is due to our gremlins playing a role in where exactly we can look for animals, and apparently we both decided to look for animals in exactly the same place. I was actually desperately following the call of the owl until I bumped into Brett and Viam in front of us. Oh, we'll try and figure out a route. I had a feeling I might bump into them due largely to the tire tracks in the road. We shall have to be slightly more daring in our explorations of the area. Using my master tracker skills at tracking down Brent. Right, I think what we shall do, we shall be brave. We shall not fear. We shall go to the southern boundary. Perhaps it is like when you are returning to a sport or exercise after injuring yourself, and you've got that initial fear of hurting yourself. Maybe, but then you actually discover that you have got that full range of motion, you just haven't quite put it into practice yet. Maybe that is what we should do. Sorry, I'm distracted by something. Speaking of master tracking skills, I'm looking, Dave, at the line on the edge of this mud wallow. A perfectly level line. And I guess that must have been a water level indicator. I can't think of what else it might be. Doesn't seem to be a drag along there. Very interesting. And there's the hole of the freshwater crab that inhabits this particular pan. But it is a little bit scraped. So what on earth is responsible for that line along there? I'm not sure. I genuinely have no idea. Must be the water. I mean, I guess that it is the water level. It must be. It can only be the water level. It's too consistent. It is such a distinct colour. A mystery. A mystery is afoot, Dave. And I don't know the answer to it. I'm going to have to puzzle over what that might be. I cannot think of what would make that, except the waterline. Your guess is absolutely as good as mine. It could only be the waterline. It can't even be a warthog tusk or an elephant. It's too straight. It's too level. Has to be. There's nothing else it can be but the previous water level. But isn't that interesting? Totally fascinating. Oh, sorry. Sorry, Dave. I was set off without watching where Dave was looking. Totally my fault. I chatted a little bit about my distinct dislike of centipedes this morning, and I don't know what it is about them. Because I'd be far happier catching a venomous snake than I would be catching a centipede. Got some kind of atavistic instinct within me that says, oh, don't touch those, which I'm not proud of and I'm very much working on. You shouldn't really have things that make your skin crawl in the bush or you're in for a difficult time. And Kathy was actually wondering a bit about the difference, because I said I'm quite happy with millipedes. Kathy was wondering about the difference between millipedes and centipedes. First of all, Kathy, centipedes are much more flattened. Yes, they have lots of legs in the same way millipedes have lots of legs, but centipedes are very flat. So their legs go out at the side, whereas millipedes are more rounded, a little bit like little mini buses, if I could explain it like that, with their legs on the bottom. Now, millipedes have two pairs per segment. Centipedes have one pair per segment, and of course that is what groups millipedes and centipedes together in one group, is their segmented multiple segments to their bodies. And I'm looking really nicely, Kathy, for a millipede, although I think Brent has found the bird he's been looking for. Let's jump on board with him.
Look at this. Definitely one of the most impressive bird species we get out here. It is the ground hornbill. Massive bird. This particular individual is a male. And he's out foraging. We would have heard him calling earlier this morning. That doo, 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 doo. And they often call just before dawn and through dawn and through the sunrise, and they're quite silent again till sunset. Incredible hunters and renowned for their snake-killing abilities. A very interesting bird. It's one of the more endangered bird species, and mostly due to loss of habitat and the use of insecticides and pesticides. But fortunately now the laws have changed with all those things and they are making a bit of a comeback. But there's only about 230 breeding pairs in the whole of South Africa. Oh, what's he found there? Look at that. So, I've been making some strange noises this morning to try attract birds' attention, and Shazzy in Texas is wondering why I go psh, 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 in Memphis, in Tennessee, sorry, not Texas. It imitates an alarm call, and with a lot of alarm calls with birds, they'll actually come out to have a look to see what's going on. I'm just going to see if we can find this hornbill again. So, they're one of the most longer-lived birds we have out in the bush. They live to about 40, 45 years. And he is carrying on foraging the thicket there. We'll see if we can get the last view. And the juveniles will spend up to about 8 to 10 years with the adults. And the males are the ones that leave their natal flock. So it's not uncommon sometimes to find groups of five or six ground hornbills together. And the females will actually take over mom's mantle, so to speak, in the breeding, chief breeding position. And all the other females will just hang around and look after mom and the babies. Oh, it seems going into some thickets there now, unfortunately. So the male will migrate between different groups. So being very long-lived, they are, those daughters have to wait quite a long time, and obviously quite a few of them never get the opportunity to breed. Also, they are very finicky breeders. They need sort of large hollows in very big trees. And if anything disturbs them around that site, they'll often abandon it and they're not mate for 10 years. So it is quite a problem for them, and that's one of the other reasons why they are quite endangered, but they're still an absolutely awesome creature to see. Bouleray is wondering how I could identify that was a male so quickly. Well, one of the main reasons is initially, what would lend my thinking towards a male is the fact that it was by himself. Normally, females would be in a little flock. Secondly, if we have a look there, I saw the front of his wattles, and he didn't have a blue spot. So let me actually find a picture for you. The females have a different coloured spot in the centre of those wattles, and the wattles are not quite as pronounced. Hornbills. Hopefully they got a nice picture. So there we go, you can see the male, the very, very red, nice and bulbous. Also, the casque is slightly more pronounced. The casc is this little top part of the beak on the, there. Now there hopefully is a picture of a female. We can't zoom. They don't have a close picture of the female. But she's got a blue spot right under her chin. And also you can see that the wattle's not nearly as developed. And the casc isn't as prominent. But there's a blue chin spot right under the female's chin. Obviously the male's a bit bigger, beak's a bit more robust. And that, wait, so 1 second, V, I'm sorry. The juveniles, and when we do see them, they have a yellow wattles. So that's how you tell if it's a juvenile. When they're juveniles, it's very difficult to sex them. But there we go. That's how we tell the difference between a male and a female. Louis DeLion says, wow, he's got such an impressive beak. He could dig quite deep down with that. Do they eat meat too? They mostly eat meat. They will eat certain fruits, but they're mostly carnivorous. Most of their diet is made up of lizards and snakes and small rodents and even ground-nesting birds. Their chicks, like lapwings. But yes, they don't dig too much with their beak. A weapon and anything else to get hold of any prey that happens to scuttle past them. So guys, I'm about to go through a little dip, and with the way the gremlins have been behaving, we might lose you for a second. Beautiful big flower. It's called a lion's eye hibiscus. Now, the other morning when it was pouring with rain, James and Jamie showed you a massive hawk moth, nearly the same size as James's hand. And it's called an arrow sphinx hawk moth. And they lay their eggs exclusively on this flower. So this is the host, or the larval host plant, of the arrow sphinx hawk moth. Very, very pretty. Oh, and from a flower to something that lacks any distinguishing bright color at all. Let's have a look what it is.
Except, of course, for the bright white tusks. Olive and Emma, our five-year-olds who requested elephants, I really hope you two are still awake. I know that the sunset safari is very late where you are, but hopefully you are still wide awake and watching our sunrise safari, because there you go. Sorry, it is sunrise. It is a sunrise safari. There you go. A lovely little elephant for you. Hello, gorgeous. Have you been digging in the dirt? What a nice surprise. Oh, wild asparagus, trunk full of wild asparagus, yummy. Something that we can eat as humans as well. And a whole big mouthful. That clump is going to be obliterated, and it's gone. That clump of wild asparagus is gone. Something that Ellie's very definitely enjoy. This is the same herd that we had yesterday afternoon on the sunset safari. There's a couple of really sweet youngsters that I'm hoping are going to slowly move towards us. It looks as though their general direction is straight towards the vehicle. Oh, I know the feeling, girl. I've also got a sore eye. I'll explain that story in a moment, but safe to say Dave is becoming quite the expert at eye fly removal. There you go. The accordion-like stretching of the trunk. And we spoke about how long trunks really are, and Gary was asking about that. You can see this is sort of at its, not quite at its shortest, almost though, at roughly 2 meters. If you take it from the absolute base of the trunk, if you take it from the tusks, it's a bit shorter than that, probably about just over, close to a meter and a half. Oh, dust bath. Using her foot to loosen the dirt and her trunk to throw it underneath her. And that's, when they throw it onto their bellies like that, it's actually what lends me to the suggestion that they enjoy the feeling more than anything else. Oh, now over her back, forming a nice protective coat for when the sun comes out. I really think they just enjoy it. Hey, girl. You are beautiful. Using her heel and her toenails. Having a wonderful time. I'm just going to be quiet for a moment because you can hear what she's doing. To hear her throw the dirt when she does. Distraction. I found a bulb. Looks like a potato. Oh, was that not nice at all, girl? Or was it just dirty? Was it sandy? Oh, I think it was sandy. Nobody likes a crunch. Let's try that again. And a drop again. Okay, we have the world's clumsiest elephant. There we go. Well done, girly. And it's out again. Back up and into the mouth. You got to put it further in there, girl. There you go. That should work. Bit of wastage happening there. Oh no, I don't think she likes it. She keeps spitting parts of it out. Oh, sorry, girl. That must have been disappointing. I know exactly what that feels like when you take a bite of a meal that you've been really looking forward to and just isn't as nice as you expected. There are some great fundamental disappointments in life, and that is one of them. Some kind of tuber looked very much like a potato. I have no idea which particular plant it happened to be. It could have been a bulb of an orchid or something similar. I love this herd. They are such a peaceful group. Walking behind us, we can't show you at the moment, but there's a little one coming. Hello, big girl. Just don't swing too fast, Dave. There she is. She just came up to have a sniff at the back of the vehicle. Her little one is going to come and give us some revs. Believe it or not, there's a baby elephant there. There it is. Oh, you're so scary. You're so scary. Oh, my goodness. I'm so intimidated. Yes, you're very intimidating. Oh, little one, please don't scare me like that. Oh, they're too sweet when they do that. My favorite. Oh, gentle rumbles from the rest of the herd. That's a little female, that calf, interestingly enough. It's not often that the female calves do that. She was obviously feeling particularly brave this morning. A sassy female calf. We've become something of an obstruction in this road. However, I think that Ephraim can probably move past me. Morning. And before I reposition, I'll show you exactly what I mean about my right eye. Dave very kindly saving me from the fly that flew in. He's becoming an expert in rescuing the various presenters from the insects that tend to bombard our retinas. I might need, at some point, I might need Dave to check it once again for me, make sure we got all the fly out. I think it's just a little bit scratched. Nothing too serious. Interesting conversation that apparently happened with James, and this is an update from Deborah, our armchair traveller, and that was a description that he gave about elephants not liking bulbs, and that you apparently witnessed them digging them up and then spitting them out fairly recently with him. And the answer, Deborah, is absolutely there are certain bulbs that they just don't like. There are also certain bulbs that I think are toxic to elephants, that they know are toxic and to avoid. And they are even more so toxic to us. But I have seen them eat bulbs before. There are certain ones that they dig up and chew with relish. And probably what happens is you'll find that they are looking for that particular type of bulb. And I'll do some research and just remind myself which one it is. It's not the Bushman's poison bulb. And I'll figure out which one that is, because I think that's what happens, is that they find a bulb, they dig it up, and then they just want to taste test and see if that's the one that they do like, and then realize that actually, no, it probably isn't, and decide to move on from there. I think the rest of the herd must already have crossed. I thought maybe the rest of them would be coming down, but I'm glad we caught the stragglers. Let's reposition ever so slightly. I'm terribly impressed by our signal. It's holding out spectacularly. Hello, girly. What? I think this little girl wants to come again. Hello. Yes, we're watching you. Yes, you're full of mischief. Distracted by breakfast. Oh, hold on. Hello. Here's a straggler. He's just going to wander across the road. Look at that swelling on his trunk. He's got some kind of mole or something. Or a growth. Almost like a wart. That's interesting. I haven't seen that before. I wonder what caused that. Maybe a little bit of a cut and an infection, possibly. Damn, and it's a little boy as well. Little male with warts on his nose. That's not ideal when you're a teenage male elephant. I'm just going to shift off out of the way of this other vehicle. And while I do, because it's going to put us closer to the power line. Eula, we're actually wondering a very good question about, and often asked by guests in a sighting such as this, and that is whether or not elephants, since we've seen them trees, whether or not they ever push over utility poles like the ones we're sitting under right now. And the answer is very occasionally it does occur. For the most part, those poles, and I can actually feel it. Bye-bye. Cheers, guys. I can actually feel it sitting underneath them. They can actually make quite a noise, an electrical field that surrounds them. And I think that is what really puts an elephant off going and rubbing on them. Ellies are disappearing, so we'll just give you one last view before they do. But they do occasionally play a little bit of a role. They're far more destructive in digging up water pipes, that is where, and of course walking over fences, as we saw this morning. I have seen other animals use them as rubbing posts, so that does occur. But generally, elephants quite good around electrical or utility poles, and telephone wires and so on. But they have to be very carefully or very well constructed. Absolutely, Brenda. I agree with you. I think that that elephant looked terribly disappointed in the bulb that she managed to dig up. She got so excited, she kept dropping it and then kept trying, and it still didn't taste nice, and eventually she just got over it. I know exactly how she feels. I've definitely had those moments before. How's it? How are you? Good, thanks. Hi, guys. How's it? Any updates from that side? Perfect, thanks. Yeah, they cross straight through us and out the other side. And Arethusa, anything? Okay, cool. All right. Thank you very much. Have a fantastic day. Cheers, cheers. Sorry? I'll say hello to Tandy. Okay, sharp. Okay, I'll let her know. Bye-bye. Tandy, of course, being our lovely chef. Good question from Deb before our elephants disappear completely. Oh, we'll stop completely, just in case we're about to lose our signal. Oops. I tried to stop completely. I forgot about the slight roll forward. Deb, do I think the drought affected the taste or the nutrients contents of the bulbs? It's possible. Anything's possible out here. Maybe like, as you suggested, like an unripe fruit doesn't taste all that nice. Definitely a possibility. I certainly wouldn't be able to say no to your suggestion. However, I think it is just that particular one wasn't to her high taste bud culinary standards. Fortunately, not a problem we have with the lovely Tandy as our chef. Our Ellies have disappeared across the southern boundary, and I think I have pushed the limits of our signal right up to its final point. But why don't you head back to Brent and see what he's up to?
VM and I are checking around quarantine. Oh, yay. Now, I know a lot of you out there, VM's not sure what I've seen. He thinks it's a butterfly. It's actually a flower. So we've got quite a few little different species of flower here. And that's the wonderful thing, that after the rain, we're gonna get quite a lot. So I'm gonna bring you a couple. Put number one there. Just saw another one down here. And there's number two. One of my favorites, number three. Here we go, number three coming. One of the most beautiful and exquisite little flowers. Now.
The yellow one this side.
Vim spotted a yellow one, he says. That one, well done, Vim. That's also a very interesting little flower. So we've got four now. I think we can safely get a few more before we decide to chat about them. I'm looking for one more in particular. But I think that's going to occur. Oh, yes. And as always, the wonderful thing is to find something you don't know as well, so I can take it home and try to figure it out. And then we had... There we go. So we've got quite a collection of flowers. And that's all from this one little spot, which is one of the reasons I came here. So let's line them up in order. Okay, here we go. Jump in here now. So the first one is one we've seen quite a lot of. That is the Oldenlandia, and a really beautiful little star-shaped flower. And they are a heliotrope. So basically, this little guy is going to sit like this, and the sun's over there. And during the day, the flowers, just the head of the flowers, I can't just move it, is just going to follow the sun really slowly, even so slow that we can't see it with the eye. And it'll keep trying to keep as much sun as possible. Now, that's the Oldenlandia, and that's one I've definitely showed to you guys before. Put him off to the side. So now, this is a slightly more interesting. So we have a look, we've got two here. Now, don't they look quite similar? So you can see the shape of the leaves is very similar, but the color is slightly different. You can see this one's got some seeds as well. So these are both indigophoras. You can see the color of the flower is slightly different. So these are both, and they're two different species of indigophoras. Very difficult, there's multiple species of them, but they're generally known as the indigo dye plants. So the roots of this particular plant species are used traditionally, specifically by the Zulus, to stain the baskets. So the roots are boiled up and that comes out a really sort of purpley red almost color, and then that's used to stain the traditional baskets. They are, can also be used for colds and flus and other things. Now, this one, although it's one of my favorites, is the one that you can pretty much, there's nothing really about it. There's no special stories medicinal uses. I just think this flower is just exquisite. And the name is also wonderful. It's called a blue haze or an evolvus. Now, you'll always find these on disturbed soil, so quite often close to roads, in erosion areas. But I just think it's very pretty. That's why I like it a lot. Here we go, and moving on to the next one. And here we go, tiny little yellow flower. But the interesting thing about this particular plant is not its flower. It's what eats the leaves. So this is the host plant for my favorite family of butterflies, which are the acrias. So this plant is actually highly noxious. So the caterpillar phase of the acria butterflies feed off this plant, and they sequester hydrogen cyanide. And that's what makes the adults highly noxious, and so the birds don't eat them. So this plant doesn't even have an English name. It only has a scientific name, which is Waltharia indica. Very, very cool little plant. And I always check them when I see to see if I can see a little acria caterpillar crawling on it. So there we go. Oops, that fell down there. Now, one of the more common flowers we have, but we normally always look at the big purple one, which is nice and easy to identify, but this is an Ipomea of sorts, a morning glory, but just a different one, a little one. There we go. So used for colds, flus, and all sorts of different things. Now, when I initially saw this very beautiful flower we have here, maybe I was right. I thought it was an... for a second I thought I was wrong. I just think it's a slightly bedraggled flower, or the leaves are slightly bedraggled. It's been eaten by caterpillars. But this is the beginning of a wing-seeded sesame. No, it's not. It's not a sesame. The flower shape's wrong. So I actually don't know what this one is. I'm going to definitely have to hit the books when we get home to see if I can find out what it is. It could be related to the sesames. It could be a slight wrong shape for the polygonums. So we have a mystery flower, and definitely see if I can identify what that one is. So we're now quite high up on an open area here. So I think we're going to loop down towards the main part of quarantine, and we could find a few more flower species to show you. Lots of blue haze, that very pretty little blue flower here. Anna-Marie says, ground hornbill. Thanks, Brent. I wanted to see one this morning. Anna-Marie, I want to see one every morning and every afternoon. So here's another one that I was looking for. It's growing in a nice little bunch, quite a lot of it around here. And this one's quite nice because I don't even have to get out of the car for it. Now, very easy one. I know a lot of our long-time viewers will be able to identify that in a heartbeat. So that's what I'm going to let you guys do. I'm not going to tell you what this flower is. I'm going to let you tell me. So if you know the name of this flower, please send me the answer. And you can do that on email via questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. What flower is this that I'm holding? Probably the most shown flower on Safari Live. And there's another one, probably the second most shown flower on Safari Live. I'm not going to jump out for that one. You got him there. The blue Commelina. Commelina erecta. Named after three botanists, three brothers, and the two largest petals there represent two brothers who made major discoveries in the world of botany. And underneath, where's my finger gone? Oh, there we go. Underneath, there's a tiny little petal underneath the staples there that represents the third brother who died before he could do anything particularly impressive. Poor guy. You'll have different flowers growing at different areas and also at different stages of the summer. And you amazingly have certain flower species that will only flower once every couple of years. Some are so rare as once every 10 years. One of the reasons I love wildflowers so much, it's a constant challenge to try to figure out what's out and about that particular year. Now there is a very awesome flower. Very, very awesome flower. Oh, I'm excited, Vim. Are you excited for this flower, Vim?
Not in particularly.
Not in particularly. There we go. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Now, this is from a bush rather than from a plant. And I'm going to have to double check. I'm pretty sure I know what it is, but I'm not 100% sure. It looks like a little saffron flower. Let's have a sniff, see what's happening. Almost odorless. Vim, you want to have a smell? There you go. So almost odorless, but you can see how it's developed with this really extended section with the pollen on it to make it as easy as possible for the different insects to pollinate this particular flower. Pretty sure it's a little saffron, but I don't have my tree book with me, so I'll double check that for you guys and let you know on the Sunset Safari. So we've got two to confirm for the Sunset Safari. Go. VM is trying very hard to get you one of the biggest and most beautiful butterfly species we have here. I think he's about to land them. There he is. You got him?
No, where did he land?
Okay, just there. Oh, wait, maybe. Yes, there. You got him there? A little bit to the left? There, center screen.
Oh,
there we go. That is called a citrus swallowtail. And while we look at that beautiful butterfly, I Walk in the Rain, Judy and Astralina all got that flower correct. It is called a string of stars, and another name for it is a lamb's tail. Isn't that a beautiful butterfly? So I'm trying to see if I move forward or back, whether you'll get a slightly better view. No, definitely not backwards, maybe forwards. Oh, no, not really. I think we're in the best spot. There we go. It's a really big butterfly and very, very pretty, very fast flying. So well done to Vim. Probably one of the hardest of the butterfly species outside the tiny little blues to get on camera. And we can't really see, but it does have, like some of the owls, it's got eyes on the base of its wing to put off predators when it's stationary like this. But when it's moving, it has a very fast flight because, of course, probably quite tasty to the different bird species. There we go. And as I spotted that, oh, it just never seems to end today. Let's have a look. I saw another very pretty flower. You got it, Vim?
Mm-hmm. What, the white one?
Yep.
So is that the same?
That is a different white flower now, and another one of the ones I like. It's almost a semi-succulent, but it's not really. It only grows where there's quite a lot of water under the ground, and that is called an anthericum. Again, another one that doesn't really have a common name. And also one that's just very, very beautiful and not much uses it from a human. And if we go another few centimeters, we have a different species of camelina. There we go. So the cousin to the blue one we just showed you.
The orange one.
The yellow there. So you can see the, oh, look, and it's got a robber fly pollinating it. So you can see the exact same shape as the blue one, except this is yellow. So this is a yellow camelina. And the robber fly has departed. So if you look carefully, there's so much to see. And a lot of this stuff has come about just because of the rain. So I'm very excited. Wildflowers are one of my favorite things out here. So while we continue to see if we can find any more flowers, species, and possibly a butterfly or three, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
And it appears as though miracles do occur. We are on the eastern edge of Juba. We have challenged Rusty, and Rusty has risen to the challenge. We have signal, we have picture. What a glorious way. And it seems as though, just pushing at that little boundary, perhaps we were a bit too scared to push Rusty as far as she could go. It seems as though there might be a bit of a black hole in the middle, but we can definitely skirt the edges. So this morning, ladies and gentlemen, Rusty rides the eastern side of Juma, which is fantastic news. The sun is sort of shining. The birds are singing. Perhaps paralyzed force and gesture without motion kept us from testing it as far as she needed to go. This is wonderful news. Apart from the slight rattle that I can hear in the back, but that's okay. We'll double check that once we reach the end of our sunrise safari. How glorious it is to be here. Kathy, Kathy in Nevada. I was right in the middle of chatting about the centipede and the millipede before we got distracted by ground hornbills and other such creatures, and elephants actually. They were the other distraction. Kathy, I hope you're still watching. You wanted to know the difference between a centipede and a millipede. Mr. Waterbuck, your timing is impeccable. Let's go a little bit forward, see if we can't get a nice view of this waterbuck bull. Oh, it's all right, boy. Don't run away, it's okay. Nope, he's off. He's had it. Beautiful waterbuck bull. I love that backwards over the shoulder look that waterbuck do. Kathy, shall we try that again? We try talking about millipedes and centipedes once again. As I said, laterally flattened is a centipede, whilst I described millipedes sort of like a bus shape with their legs underneath. One pair of legs per segment on a centipede, whilst millipedes past their fourth segment have two that stick out. Now keep an eye out for a nice example for you. The biggest difference is their behavior and their diet. So millipedes, and the reason why I'm quite happy and content to let them wander across my hands and climb wherever they would like to, is the fact that they are vegetable matter eaters. They are herbivores. And whilst they are highly toxic to eat, you don't want to pop one in your mouth and crunch through it. Not that one would be tempted to do that anyway, unless absolutely necessary. They have a cyanide-type toxin that one would not want to munch. That being said, they've got no other way of causing you any kind of harm. Now, centipedes, on the other hand, they are tricky creatures. They are active hunters. They are predators of other insects. And in fact, there's that famous comparison between a scorpion and a centipede. It's one of those interesting examples where scorpions can feed on centipedes, centipedes can feed on scorpions, and it very much depends on the size. And occasionally they do fight to the death. They're also much faster than millipede, lightning fast, because they're active predators, and they are venomous. The difference, of course, being venom is injected through a bite or a sting, like a scorpion, a snake, or a centipede. A poison is something that has to be ingested in order to work. So I think perhaps my slight, what would we describe it as? I'm not going to use the word fear. It's not quite a fear. It's almost a fear, not quite. My slight dislike of centipedes, apprehension, my slight wariness when it comes to approaching centipedes is the fact that they can bite me or a scorpion could sting me. Whereas with a millipede, short of popping it in my mouth and chewing it and swallowing it, it's not going to do me any serious harm. But perhaps that is where the biggest difference lies. I just can't understand why I'm okay with snakes and scorpions, but centipedes seem to be the thing. I actually mentioned that I did that sleep out, and I was sitting on a log for a good hour, which I suppose in itself is a point against my fear of centipedes. When we use the word fear, let's just go for it. Before discovering that there was a centipede probably about this long and about this thick underneath me. And suddenly it shot out right next to me. I must tell you, if I'm completely honest, there's very few times that I squeal like a girl, but I squealed like a girl. And I levitated. I was not quite aware of how high I could jump up until that moment. I amazed myself with the amount of distance I covered from sitting on the log to standing about 10 meters away in a very short period of time. I rivaled leopards in their charging speed. Maybe not quite, but it felt like it at the time. That, Kathy, is the difference between centipedes and millipedes. I'm just, Dave and myself, just doing a quiet cruise around up towards Buffelsoek Dam, see how far we can really push this signal thing. Oh, Michelle, I actually have an update from you. It's a bit more of an update for all of the viewers. I'm just gonna try and show you that African hoopoe, but it's taken flight. Michelle, you were wondering where those lions rushed off to. You said you missed it. They rushed south across our southern boundary into Chitwa, And interestingly, I've just bumped into one of the guides that can drive there, and he said that they lay down about 50 meters in, or about 100 meters in from our southern boundary. So, you know, such is life. It's three males. I think it was two males that were walking through Juma. Two males walking through Juma, responding to the calls of the third, who was further south. So that is where the three, at least three Birmingham boys are. That doesn't mean that there isn't a fourth or a fifth somewhere in the nearby vicinity. Also doesn't negate the possibility of us bumping into a lion right here. They do love this Buffalo's Hook Dam area.
They're inside Allen Down. They're only about 50 meters from the Mala Mala boundary at the moment. So they're not a fun for now.
Oh, that Birmingham boy has finally left the Nkuhuma lady and moved on, and she's probably reunited back with her pride towards Simbambili. Although they did clearly, as Brent showed you this morning, they did clearly come through Juma last night. Now, Megan in Ontario was wondering on the subject of our mating lions, how long will it be before we start to see signs of possible pregnancy? And the answer is about 2 to 2.5 months. So if we get a rough gestation period, because it differs from lion to lion and it differs from area to area and captive versus wild lions, but their gestation period is roughly 100 days, so just over 3 months, and they start showing signs only very late in that pregnancy, and I would say probably sort of 2 to 3 weeks before the birth, when you really start to see the bulges. You have to look very closely otherwise, but also to that point where their nipples swell up in the way that they do and become far more prominent. So that's when we can start expecting to see signs of pregnancy from that particular lioness. That does not preclude the possibility that some of the other Nkuhuma lionesses are already pregnant. It's just that we can't see signs of it. Ouch, biting fly. And it's distinctly possible that they might be. We just haven't seen signs yet. So we might see signs of pregnancy earlier in some of the other Nkuhuma ladies. Well, this has been a highly successful morning. We've made it all the way to Buffalo's Hook Dam with signal. Dave is grinning in the back. I'm pretty happy as well. And we're going to say our fond farewells for now. We will catch up with you for the sunset safari this afternoon. In the meantime, thank you for joining us, as always, and we will catch up with you later. Cheers, everybody.
So as we're nearing the end of the sunrise safari, we've got one or two more flowers to show you. Now, this is possibly most of any kid who's grown up in the bush. It's the nemesis. It is the devil thorn, or the Duivelsdoring, or the Bokdoring, as Wim calls it in Afrikaans. So they don't have any thorns yet. They haven't grown. The thorns are actually the seeds. So they are, in certain parts of West Africa, even eaten in times of famine. Sorry about that, guys. And then the most interesting thing I've managed to find out about the devil thorn is there are about 12 recorded cases of this plant being used for very nefarious and devious means. They have been used as a murder weapon in 12 different cases, mostly up in West and Central Africa. So what happens is they have a very small tri-thorned little seed. It's actually three separate seeds that are joined together. I will try find you one once they start coming out. And those seeds are then soaked in poison and then laid on like the doormat of someone's house. So as that person walks out, stands on the thorns and is poisoned. And apparently it's a very slow and agonizing death depending on what poison's used. So the plant itself is not poisonous, but the thorns are used as a vector to poison people. And I think that's quite fascinating. I didn't know that till very recently. But as I said, the nemesis of any kid who's grown up in the bush. When you grow up in the bush, you really don't like to wear shoes. I still don't like to wear shoes, but if you tromp around barefoot, you'll have very painful feet if there are a lot of devil thorns around. So quite often, they always grow in these nice big open areas. So it looks wonderful to cavort across. And it ends up being very painful. So we're going to take one last question before the end of the safari. Maybe we'll see another flower, who knows? But Michael would like to know what the name of the blue flower was. It was called a blue commelina. And we saw its cousin, the yellow commelina, C-O-M-M-I-L-I-N-A. And a very, very, very pretty flower. Now, a lot of you have been watching the safaris for a long time. You'll remember a red flower on quarantine that is invasive. VM was just mentioning to me, the draft has got a good job at, done a good job at keeping them under wraps. You got it there, VM?
It's these long ones, aren't
they? No. Behind it, zoom. Oh, no, a little bit to the left. Oh, I can't see it now. But we'll show you on the sunset safari, the red star Zenna, the exotic flower that in certain wet years is all over quarantine. But if you want to see some more flowers and hopefully some big cats, join us for the sunset safari. Till then, adios.